So first of all, the book is such a beautiful journey. Right from chapter one to the end, there are so many heartwarming stories that absolutely thrill me. And getting down to just sit and read this itself is such an honor to me. And talking, before we go into the questions, I will just do a small reading from the first chapter itself, which is a very interesting read. Now, the first chapter of the book starts with how both of them are absolutely clueless. That is, Dr. Colonel Rao and General UK Sharma, they're absolutely clueless about what's going to happen, where they're going. And let me read out to you what happens. Captain Sharma and Captain Rao, sir, traveling to Assam on posting. Which regiment? AMC, sir, we replied. Doctors, eh? Yes, sir. What are you two buggers doing walking around the platform like dead men? He asked. Trying to find a place to sleep, sir. Major Rajvardhan, Grenadiers, he said, putting out his hand. Keep your luggage in the cloakroom and follow me. He ordered, and the ice was broken as easily as that. We went out of the smelly platform into the city outside. Major R was a hardcore infantry professional posted in Nagaland. He was traveling from Indore after a temporary assignment back to his unit and had been in Allahabad a number of times before. A sumptuous meal at the famous Amritsari Dhaba outside the railway station was followed by a brisk 2-mile military-style march to Hira Halwai shop in civil lanes where we had the world-famous Kala Jamun with Rabdi, with Panditji, our former Prime Minister, the earlier Soviet Premier Khrushchev, and the present owner's late father fondly gazing down upon us from an old black and white photograph enlarged on the wall for all of us to see. At 7 in the morning, we steamed into the new Bungeju. The surroundings were lush and brilliantly green, just like countryside in Kerala after the first spell of the rain. The arid countryside of yesterday faded rapidly from the memory. We were in Assam. So you reach Assam. And first of all, let's just go back for 2 seconds and talk about that train that you were supposed to take, which arrived a day late, which is precisely why the book is titled Yesterday's Train to Nowhere. So both of them are at the station waiting for this train. And they're very excited that it's not very delayed, because as they knew, trains used to get delayed quite often. But they were very amused that theirs wasn't. But what they didn't know, and they realized later, was that train that was pulling into the platform was yesterday's train that had arrived today. And they had no idea where it was headed. So tell us a little bit about that. How was that journey of not knowing absolutely nothing or where you're going to, and then ending up into a place where you had no idea you were going to be posted?
You never know where you're going, and you don't know where you're going to land up. But it was a great journey. I remember Yooks and I, we both left Pune railway station, you know, very dramatic fashion, hanging out of the train while the train steamed out of Pune railway station. Yooks, you remember? So the only person who was really interested in our you know, final departure on that train was the officer's mess barman from MH Kharki, who came to collect his dues because we hadn't paid his dues. So literally he ran behind the train to get his anyway. So that was the thing about the starting of the journey. And then we chugged on and chugged on, but it was absolutely fabulous. You know, you wear a uniform, you say that you're a doctor, and everybody opens out their hearts to you. It's absolutely fabulous when you wear a uniform and you say that you're a doctor. Everybody wants to feed you. Everybody wants to talk to you. Everybody wants to, you know, get close to you. It was really something which you'd never had seen before. And this is the first time we were going out in public life, so to say. and it was really nice. I remember that part of the journey very well. I don't remember much of the rest. We came onto that platform, and it was a platform like all else. But I remember that the train was just like a toy. It was a beautiful toy, a narrow gauge train, small compartments. You could, you know, literally jump from one place to the other. It was a small little toy train. It was really a toy train, and we were wondering, is it actually a train or is it something which has just been put on the platform? And when it chugged in, we realized that yes, this was a train, and it was great. And there was no place on that train. Absolutely, there were goats and chicken all over inside. And it was like a true Indian train, you know. It was a true Indian train. So we liked it very, very much.
Right. You can keep that.
Would you like to say something?
You can keep that because then it'll make more sense. So, thinking about, you just told me that, you know, the army people never really know where they are posted anyways.
Absolutely.
But if I recollect, the first part of the book very clearly states you were very excited to be posted in Kashmir. So why?
We wanted to be, everybody wanted a posting in Kashmir, if you remember.
Why so? It is such a dangerous place, right?
The field ambulance at Patan, it was a prize posting for everybody. Everybody wanted to be posted to Kashmir. And people, you know, try to get, you know, try to use a little bit of influence. I asked my dad, I want a posting to Kashmir as well. And he said, why Kashmir? I said, nice place, good weather, beautiful apples, beautiful girls. I want to go and have a look. So he said, army doesn't run the way you want it. They'll decide what they want. Dad, please try and, I want to go to Kashmir. So the posting order came and I was very sure that dad had, you know, managed to get me to posting, and that is the incident where then we saw the signal. There was no address. We saw the second time when we went to the signal center, it was written 99 APO. 99 APO is northeast. The Kashmir APO is 56. So we saw the 99 APO and we got the shock of our lives. And anyway, you can read the rest of it in the book.
Right. So coming to your experience about going to Assam and being posted there, we know that the situation that you went there wasn't that great. We know that it was difficult to get there by that train. You had to go through those little difficult conditions. So what was in your mind when you went on that train and you took that journey, even in those conditions, because you did not have a place to sleep afterwards?
It wasn't bad at all. We loved it. It was great fun. You know, once you leave the home station and you get onto the train, it was great fun. I mean, I would do it anytime again, you tell me to.
that's a beautiful spirit.
It was lovely, actually. It's only now that you go from one place to another in 2 hours, and by flight you don't even know, you don't even see the people, you don't do anything. Train journey, I just love train journeys. Major Raja Dhyaksh. I couldn't put his name, so that's why.
Would you like to add to that?
Yes, yes.
Would you like to add to that experience that you had?
Yeah, he asked me, any idea I have where's this place? I said, the way the name is named, it looks like it's next to Nagasaki, you know. But I can't tell you what the name was. He says, stop talking nonsense. And incidentally, it was not just another place in Assam. It was a place in Upper Assam, and Upper Assam is very, very interesting landscape. It's north of the Brahmaputra, and we are right at the foothills of the Great Himalayas, the Great Eastern
Beautiful
Himalayas.
View.
So we could say it was back of beyond, you know.
All right. So let's talk about the chapter 3, which is you know, where a senior officer and a wet doctor, he is asking you two for help for a treatment, both of you. And you both are like completely shocked. Who is this calling and why does they need help from us? And he asks you to assist him with anesthetizing the patient.
You know, there's this little dog called a Chihuahua. It's the rarest breed in the world. And it was there in one of the tea estates. The owner was a lady in the tea estate.
Please.
And she used to look after that dog like her own child. And that dog became pregnant and had babies. And the veterinary officer, I won't tell you his name, he called us to do the caesarean. He was going to do the caesarean, and his anesthetist, the person who used to give anesthesia, he had gone on leave, and this was an emergency. So he roped us in. And, you know, frankly speaking, anesthesia, Anil, you'll bear with me, we hardly attended the classes in anesthesia. And he said, no, you, we had three. So we had four classes in anesthesia, which the department was situated just next to the canteen, just next to the canteen. So we would go for the class, give your attendance, and go and jump into the canteen. And the thing was that we had no idea of anesthesia, and he was very confident, you are AMC doctors, you would be able to handle anything. So it was really a nightmare, you know, giving anesthesia to a little dog that was about the size of a big, large bandicoot, that dog. And we gave the anesthesia, and anyway, the whole process sorted itself out.
The line I remember from that is, oh man, that's a rat.
No, he was a, we used to love that veterinary officer. He was prone to so much of dramatics, you know. Everything was he was a larger than life character.
That's a very interesting story. Especially the way that you've put it across, it is a very interesting story. Let's talk about the next one, which is again a very absolute favorite, is My Heroine. And that chapter is a very interesting chapter. And he has to ask a very embarrassing question to a senior officer. Now, I don't know how he managed to do that. But my question to you is mainly, before you ask that embarrassing question, I mean, you'll definitely share that question with us. But before you ask that embarrassing question to your senior officer, did you practice in front of the mirror?
In our army life, which I have extrapolated on into this book. And this is one of those incidents where this girl had all kinds of problems because of the altitude. And we came to know later that this was a kind of a particular medical problem. But it was very nice for us to come to know, and we had to ask the question, because that was what the diagnosis hinged on. So we asked the general whether he and his wife were related before they got married, you know, because that establishes consanguinity. And I thought he was going to beat me up and throw me out of the room. But he was huge person. And but then he was shocked. He said, "How did you know?" I said, "Then at that time I realized that probably our diagnosis was correct." And then he said yes. There were a lot of opposition in the family, but we went ahead and got married. And the pathologist there was Major Murli. I don't know if you know him, sir.
Yeah, Veer Chakra.
I don't remember. Great guy. So he was the person who called up and said, "I think you have got the diagnosis." And the worst thing is, when I transferred that, I don't know if you guys know Bhagwanani. Bagu's dad was in Eastern Air Command, so we managed to get her by helicopter. When it landed in Tezpur, she was fine. And the physician was not from FMC. He said, "Hey, unnecessarily, you're troubling everybody, ringing up and evacuating a perfectly normal person, and everything is fine." So it was quite a embarrassment.
Okay. So if you don't mind.
Yeah, okay.
So, if you don't mind me asking, where is your heroine now?
Oh, I don't know. No idea. No idea.
Did not get a time to get in touch.
Oh, yeah. We quickly change the heroines nowadays.
Oh. All right. So, all these stories which he's mentioned are small, minute things that sometimes leaves a mark on us. When you go ahead, these stories become a part of your life. They have a large impact on you, your family, and
so much of an impact on our life that our wives refuse to listen to us anymore. that's why we put it down on paper, so that some other innocent poor chap will get caught in this. Wives have refused to listen to us. Children also are reaching the saturation point.
So tell us a little bit more about that. Another interesting chapter is Romeo, Juliet and the Elephant, which is title itself is so interesting. Tell us a little more about
that. That is our dentist. Colorful character.
Very colorful character.
Lalsa said.
He came from Western India, and he was one of the rare ones from that state.
The story itself is very rare. I never expected to find such a story in the book. Please share the incident with us.
No. Anyway, crazy fellow. Assam agitation was on at that time, and they completely refused the vehicles from going from one station to another. They stopped. So if we had to go, anybody had to go, we had to make a patient, put him in the ambulance, and then with two guards with, you know, around in there with a rifle, we used to transfer the patient to Tezpur. So this fellow was highly involved with one of our nursing officers, and he used to love that. Galan, she used to love him back. Okay, so station commander got news of this and separated the two. This fellow used to go on his, he had a small Rajdoot motorcycle in that Bobby movie. So he used to go every evening to Tezpur, almost 45, 50 kilometers and come back. And one day his bike broke down, so he took the CEO's Jeep and
stole it.
Not stole, I mean, it's lying there. He started it and took off. Borrowed it.
Yeah.
And Gurmeet was our, he was a different name, you remember this. He came running, CEO saab ki gaddi kho gayi sir.
Cycle thodi hai jo kho jayegi.
It's a huge, huge problem, you know, missing a vehicle. And then we realized that probably PP had taken it, you know. It's a very amusing, anyway. That
story is definitely worth the read. It is very funny right from the beginning to the end, and the characters, the incidents are narrated so well. I didn't want the story to end. I was flipping the pages and I was like, please don't end the story right here. So now that, you know, we've covered a couple of things from the start of the book, I don't want to get to the end of the book because the end of the book is more beautiful than the start of the book. And I want you guys to pick it up and read it. You will see how each of those incidents sort of connect in the end, and it has a beautiful ending. You should definitely take a read on the, especially the last chapter. It is a very beautiful
only read. Reason why I wrote this book is, as Soumya said, it was the COVID times, we had no work, so I decided to put down these things on paper before dementia sets in. That's number one. And the second is, if somebody read the book, and you know, everybody has this fear, especially the mothers sending their sons into the army, you know, it's a terrific organization. It's probably the best organization in this country today. There's no doubt about it. Send your sons freely, send them into the army. And daughters also. And the army looks after you. I mean, you have the whole army behind you, you know. You can't say that for any other organization in this country. You can't say that. The army is behind you. That's it. You go like a king, you know, all over the place. Even though you don't know there's nobody behind you, but you still go like a king because you know that ultimately. So that's the reason I wrote this book, is that get over this fear. Send your kids. I myself, as a professor of and head of the department in my college, I've sent 7 or 8 boys into AFMC. Oh, Jaktar knows. He's responsible for selecting 2 or 3 of them into the AMC. I love these boys to join the army, and the boys are keen. They're very keen, you know. I have so many of these youngsters who come and tell me, sir, I want to join the army. Yeah, sure, go ahead. Then they come back and say, sir, my mother says you don't have to. I won't send you. And, you know, all that thing starts again. So I'm telling all the mothers here who are going to be mothers also, please send your kids to the army. It's a great organization. It's absolutely a great organization.
I remember General UK Sharma saying everybody has to at least experience the army life a little bit in the beginning of their life or during their youth. It is important that they experience that. And that is very true. That is very true. So since the book is dedicated to these little incidents that impact you, and as a young doctor from your army life, you have gathered so many experiences that are very empowering and motivating to the young doctors of today. So if you had to say something to them to encourage them into the army, what would it be?
Just very simple. Life is great fun when you're young. make sure you enjoy it now, because we don't know what's going to happen later. So make full use of your younger days. It's really good fun. It's really good fun. And maybe sometime 30 years down the line, you'll also write a book like this. I would be very happy if you do. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That was for the questions that we had, and a little bit for the book that we wanted to discuss with you. Because the book is something that everybody should have in their shelf, mainly because this is not just for the army or the aspiring medical doctors, but it's also for each and every person to understand the struggles that come in life and the fun that you can have around those struggles if you have the dedication, the spirit, just like Dr. Colonel Krishna Rao today. All of them. Big hand, big cheer for everyone. Thank you so much for listening to us, and thank you so much for sharing about the book as well. So, thank you. So, a little bit before we close and head to the last part of the event, the proceeds from the book, all the royalty and the proceeds, are contributed towards the scholarship that we have for the aspiring doctors of India. And every time you buy or you encourage reading that book, you will be donating and contributing to this medical association that we have. So big round of applause to that intent and that motive that you have for that. Thank you. Thank you so much.